Okay, thank you all and welcome to the 12th meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. And I have apologies this morning from Pam Gossel. First item on our agenda is to agree whether to take item 4 in private, which is consideration of today's evidence. Can I ask committee members, are we all agreed? And I can see you also, if you could just nod or thumbs up. Okay, that's great. Thank you. We are agreed. Then move on to agenda item 2, which is consideration of two negative instruments. So I refer members to paper 1. Do members have any comments on the Age of Criminal Responsibility Scotland Act 2019, Supplementary Provision Jurisdiction Regulations 2021, or the Age of Criminal Responsibility Scotland Act 2019, Places of Safety Regulations 2021? I see Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. It's just really to note that there wasn't a children's rights and wellbeing impact assessment done on the instrument, and to be keen to hear why perhaps the government could address that at a future date. And also, given that the minimum age of criminal responsibility is going to come into force this month as 12, it's interesting that the UN have also said that actually 14 should be the minimum age of criminal responsibility, and so I'd be keen to know the reasons why the government have chosen a lower age.
Okay, thank you for that, Pam. So those points are on the record. Is there any further comments on the orders from any members? Okay, there's no further indications. Sorry, Fulton McGregor.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just wanted to put on record that I welcome the negative instrument, on the criminal age of responsibility. But I was on the committee in the last term that took this bill through the Parliament, so it's a really, really good piece of legislation. And picking up on Pam's point earlier there, there was a lot of discussion at that point that actually the age of criminal responsibility should be at a higher age. So that was something that looked at, and I know that the Scottish Government had committed to continuing to look at that, but this was a step that they took at that point. But members should be aware that a lot of members who took that legislation through, including myself, did look at the issues of making the age of criminal responsibility higher in line with other European countries. And we'd have a commitment, an outstanding commitment from the government, that they would continue to look at that as the legislation comes into place and then develops. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Any further comments? No? Okay, on that basis then, and with those points on the record, our members agreed that we would not make any formal comments to Parliament on these instruments. Okay, that therefore concludes consideration of the SSIs, and we now move on to the next item of our agenda, which is to continue taking evidence on our inquiry into women's unfair responsibility for unpaid care and domestic work. And I welcome to the meeting Thatwat Rehman, Chief Executive Officer of One Parent Family Scotland, Susie Fitton, Policy Officer Inclusion Scotland, Katrina Melville, Policy Engagement and Campaign Officer for Age Scotland, Margaret Lance, FEMIS and Ethnic Minority National Resilience Network, and Dr. Patricia Fikienc, Chief Executive Officer of YWCA Scotland. I welcome you all to the meeting and refer members to papers 2 and 3. As we have a number of witnesses today, please can I ask members to indicate which witnesses you're directing your discussion points to, and we can then open the floor to other witnesses for comments. If other witnesses wish to respond to a question, please can I ask them to indicate by typing R in the chat function of Blue Jeans, and I'll bring you in if time permits. Dead question, but clearly today's a bit about a discussion, so don't feel it's a question and answer. It's very much a discussion, so we're keen to hear discussion points from our witnesses too. I guess the one point I'd say, if you're simply wanting to concur with what someone else has said, then I don't think it's necessary to come in at that point. There'll be points when you'd be brought in, and you could make that point at a later point in the meeting. Members can also use the chat function on BlueJeans if they wish to intervene. And so have a lot of witnesses and members present, you won't necessarily be able to see everyone on the BlueJeans platform as there's only 9 at any one time, but the clerks will advise if anyone loses connection. At the end of the session, if any of the witnesses feel that there is outstanding points that they weren't able to address, please follow up in writing and the committee will take that evidence into account. So I want to now ask each of the witnesses to make a short opening statement, starting with Satwat Rehman, please.
Thank you and good morning, everyone. We're very pleased to be here today because single mums faced a series of challenges as a result of the pandemic and also the restrictions to try to control the pandemic. When the pandemic began and lockdown was introduced, we quickly became aware how many single mothers were with no support and had been left in a difficult situation. During lockdown, many of our frontline staff were still supporting mothers and children directly, delivering food parcels, power cards, tablets and Wi-Fi connectivity, clothes, toys for babies, activity packs for children, and linking parents into food banks. We know from our working communities that many single mothers were and still are often worried about food, heating, rent or mortgage payments, and also how to access local help. They're concerned about their children's education, social development and mental health. During lockdown, many didn't have access to a computer or a tablet or access to Wi-Fi to enable children to continue with online education or for themselves to be able to deal with Job Centre Plus, do online shopping, etc. Many single parents we work with only have pay-as-you-go mobiles with limited data packages. There's also the impact on single mums of the ongoing restrictions, dealing with a non-resident parent, coping with employment when their child has been instructed to isolate at home as a precautionary measure, closed childcare, being made unemployed, accessing benefits, the cost of living, worry about benefit conditionality, etc. Many also lost child maintenance, as the staff in the child maintenance service were transferred to deal with the huge increase in universal credit claims, which meant the service no longer acted on the enforcement powers available to them so that children receive the payments that they're entitled to. And many of the single mothers who contacted a helpline during lockdown experienced some form of domestic or economic abuse by a former partner, including controlling money, resources, limiting how money and resources are used. Throughout this session, I'm going to be using the experience and input of single parents and what they've told us during this time to inform our evidence. Thank you.
Thank you. Could I hear from Susie Fitton, please?
Thank you. Inclusion Scotland welcomes the opportunity to submit evidence to the committee today about women's unfair responsibility for unpaid care and domestic work, and I will be talking specifically about disabled women and women impacted by disability, so that's women who care for a disabled person. Our research, our own research and evidence that we will share from the Fawcett Society and others has shown that women impacted by disability and disabled women often have unfair responsibility for unpaid care and domestic work within households in Scotland. The provision of unpaid care is closely interlinked with systemic and harmful gender roles, and the intersection with disability constrains women's lives. These constraints have only intensified during the pandemic. COVID-19 has intensified social isolation and mental ill health for disabled women and women impacted by disability, personal and community poverty, economic and social instability and insecurity. And whilst it has also seen communities rally round to support local residents and neighbours, the impact of the pandemic and the consequences of the ensuing emergency responses have revealed inequalities in Scotland that existed for disabled women and women impacted by disability long before COVID arrived. These inequalities have widened as economies, households and public services have locked down to contain the spread of the virus. These and systemic gender roles have only been entrenched for women impacted by disability, with poor outcomes worsened by the reduced access to social care support, routine healthcare and rehabilitation services, more pronounced social isolation, poorly tailored public health messaging, inadequately constructed mental health services, and a lack of emergency preparedness that was actually accessible and inclusive for women who were impacted by disability. Withdrawal of social care services during the pandemic saw more and more women, including disabled women, take on additional unpaid care, with the number of carers in Scotland increasing by a third. By the early stages of the pandemic, there were an estimated 1.1 million unpaid carers in Scotland, an increase of 34% as a result of the crisis. The majority of these new carers have been women, and many have been disabled women or women impacted by disability. So in short, I would say that disabled women and women caring for a disabled person have been harder hit by COVID-19, not only because they may be at greater risk of severe illness, but equally or more so because COVID-19 has supercharged the existing inequality they already face and has made new inequality much more likely. So we'll be sharing our own evidence on that and evidence from other organisations. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask Katrina Melville, please?
Thank you and good morning, convener. Thank you for inviting Age Scotland to take part in this important session. We are the national charity for older people and we aim to support, inspire and empower older people over the age of 50. While the coronavirus pandemic has impacted daily life for us all, it has exacerbated many pre-existing inequalities in our society. Older people have been impacted severely, whether that be due to high death rates and chances of severe illness, experiencing loneliness and social isolation and the resultant impact on mental health, concerns about job loss and finances, or longer term implications surrounding loss of confidence and regaining contact with others. Evidence suggests that older people from ethnic minorities, disabled older people living in care homes or who live alone, and older people experiencing poverty are among those impacted particularly. Another group of older people who have borne the brunt of much of the pandemic's impact are the large number of over 50s who provide unpaid care, whether that be to a spouse or partner, child or grandchild, parent, sibling, friend or neighbour, and the majority of these carers are women. In Scotland, it's estimated that one third of women aged between 55 to 64 are unpaid carers, which is in the region of 130,000 women. Approximately one in five women aged between 65 to 74 are unpaid carers, and one in 10 women over 75 are unpaid carers. Despite the significant contribution made by unpaid carers to our communities, we often find that many older carers do not necessarily identify as a carer, and that this can act as a barrier to them accessing the support which should be available to unpaid carers. Due to our ageing population, it is likely that the number of unpaid carers who are themselves older and who may be providing care while living with their own long-term health condition or disability will rise in coming years. Thank you again for inviting Age Scotland to attend this morning's meeting, and I look forward to participating in the discussion.
Thank you, Katrina. Can I ask Margaret Lance, please?
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, convener. And I want to say thank you so much for having me. My name is Margaret Lance. I am the co-chair of the Ethnic Minority Resilient Network Subgroup, and I'm also the vice chair for BMIS. I currently work for Waverley Care as a health improvement coordinator supporting African communities in Scotland. And I am also a community activist. So my contribution today will be based on what I know through my paid and voluntary work, what women have shared with me, and what partners have also shared with me in terms of women's unpaid and domestic work. So when the pandemic started, you know, it was something like, it's across the ocean, it's not going to come here. And with the blink of an eye, we were in lockdown. And of course, we do know that the African community and other minority communities, most of whom have no recourse to public funds, it has been very difficult and they were really hit hard. We had single parents who, some don't have English as their first language. The centers that they used to go there for support were all closed. not computer literate or had no access to computers or the access to the internet. So what BIMIS and the Ethnic Minority Resilient Network did was to step in what I would call a rapid response to provide financial support in partnership with the Scottish Government. For example, the Emergency Sustenance Grant scheme distributed up to 35,000 to around 446 referrals. That's between March and May. And of course, this included over 400 children. Not a lot, but it did do something. And up to 200 adults, of whom were also subject to no recourse to public funds. So this actually places minority women and their families in a severe risk of destitution. We know that these are the issues that have been happening. Most of them find Scotland to be home, but the lockdown has actually increased their vulnerability. And also, we're looking at what I would call missing people, not hard to reach, because I don't think there's a hard to reach community, but missing people because of their circumstances, of the situation that they find themselves in, they give up on themselves. So we kind of realized there was mental health was at a very high risk, suicide, drugs and alcohol, and these are the things that place ethnic minority communities at high risk and vulnerability. So I will be contributing in terms of what we've done and what I know and how I've been working with communities. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask Dr. Patricia Kupiek, please?
Thank you. Good morning. We at YWCA Scotland welcome the opportunity to give evidence about women's unfair responsibility for unpaid care and domestic work. Systemic gender inequality is perhaps most evident in the home. Women are expected to be primary caregivers for children and family members while maintaining essential domestic work. Scotland-specific evidence shows that 72% of mothers say they do most of the housework, such as cleaning and laundry. We know that this unfair responsibility is a result of the patriarchal society in which we live, with its outdated gender roles and expectations. We also know the ripple effects of this. Women are unable to participate fully and equally in society, including in the labour market, and our current employment culture and systems do not support or enable women to progress. This year, we published our fifth annual research report in the status of young women in Scotland, where we survey and speak with women aged 16 to 30 across Scotland about a specific issue that affects them. We knew that there was one area beyond all others that we needed to investigate this year, employment in the context of the pandemic. We heard from over 220 young women about how their lives and work had been impacted by the pandemic. One in 10 young women we surveyed said that there was zero support for those with caring responsibilities in the workplace, making juggling work and care difficult and stressful. 53% of young women did not feel confident to negotiate flexible working arrangements. Many support services for young carers stopped during the pandemic. The additional caring responsibilities often fell to young women who were in full-time education. For some young women, being a carer also meant that they were more reluctant to apply for new opportunities for fear of being discriminated against because of their caring responsibilities. We will finish our opening statement with a quote from a research participant. In my workplace, being part-time means I am not in line for promotions and progression. My reasons for working part-time include living with an anxiety disorder and caring responsibilities, both of which very disproportionately affect women, and I think many workplaces can create a facet of equality without truly engaging with the reality of what holds women's career progression back. Thank you.
Thank you, and thanks everyone for your contributions. We're now open the floor to a bit of a discussion. As I said, we'll try and get a mixture of views between committee members and our witnesses. So I'm going to start with Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe, and good morning to everybody who's on the panel. Thank you for being with us this morning, and thank you for your opening statements. You're all referred in some ways in your opening remarks to the point that we've heard before, that the pandemic has just exacerbated existing inequalities, whether those are inequalities of gender because of the patriarchal society, or of race, or of age, or ability. And I'd like to unpick the intersections a little bit, if I may, particularly the relationship perhaps between women carers who are women of colour, ethnic minorities, the issue that Margaret raised around no recourse to public funds, and how support has just been, if not absent, very difficult to access. And I wondered if you could just say a little bit more about the women and carers and others that you have direct experience with. I'll ask Margaret first, and then if I can ask Satwat to come in as well. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Yeah, in terms of women that I have supported, or that my partners have supported, who have no recourse to public funds. Having no recourse to public funds, maybe a single mother with more than one children, three to four children, it's very difficult and makes them quite vulnerable because they cannot work. Being an asylum seeker, you cannot work. How would you tell a child in the morning that there's no food at the table? So most of them end up going from one food bank to another, from one organization to another, seeking support. And that shouldn't be happening. How can we support the plan group? We are also looking at some of the concerns that have come to us. It's about students, international students with children as well, having no recourse to public funds. That I do understand. But how does that impact on these families and how they support their children? So that's me for now. I don't know if I did get answered your question or give you what you wanted.
No, thank you, Margaret. That's very helpful. Satwat, do you want to come in as well then and say just a little bit about the women that you're supporting, the lone carers that you're supporting, lone families, how they have dealt with some of the intersections, the cross-cutting inequality that they are facing.
Okay, thank you. I'll try. Quite often many of the single mums and the families we work with belong to, say, for example, more than one priority group within the Child Poverty Act. So we've got amongst the sort of children in poverty, like 40% of children in single parent families also have a disabled person at home. Over half, 54% of the children in a family with a younger mother are also in a single parent household. And as you know, there's a particular issue with young parents and lower rates of universal credit to begin with. One of the things that we're trying to challenge for the young parent campaign. But what we found was that the financial and economic impact of the lockdown, as you've said, has entrenched those pre-pandemic inequalities. I mean, there's always been the issue for single parents of that sort of dual responsibility of being the sole carer and sole breadwinner, which is a difficult challenge. And balancing act at the best of times, even pre-pandemic, has really been exacerbated by the pandemic. And as well as that, in terms of some of the intersections, we heard from a lot of parents, of the mums we work with, about how they were having to, in a way, have an enhanced caring role because they were managing so many anxieties and the mental health of the children and young people, you know, their children, as well as the impact on their own mental health and well-being, of the uncertain, so generalised anxiety that we saw amongst the population, but added to that, pressures of having to try to cope with being the only adult in lockdown at home with your children, possibly trying to work yourself at home, managing maybe three children, different age groups, working on different platforms, needing to do different work online. At the same time, you add to that some of the things that we saw when supermarkets were turning single parents away when they turned up with their children to do their shopping because it was one person allowed per household. So single parents single mums were not recognised as a group that might require additional support as a result of the lockdowns. So I think early on when we looked at all the local authority websites, there was only one or two which actually identified single parent families as one of the priority groups requiring the additional support. And that does go back to what's been said by the other speakers earlier, that what we're talking about is entrenched, systemic, patriarchal attitudes which recognise families. We still work on the model of a particular type of family. Do you know? All our services are built around that model. The workforce, labour market, everything is built around that model. So what single parents and single mums have been coping with generally was thrown into such sharper focus during this pandemic. They faced financial insecurity. There was no second income. The pressures, like I said, of balancing paid work and unpaid work. One of the previous speakers has spoken about how all sort of local face-to-face groups stopped. Isolation was a key factor for the families that we worked with, and they were much more exposed to the demands of caring for children, like I said, during lockdown. And there are many families, single parent families, like I said, where there's a disability, where there are other cross-cutting intersectional issues. And so as well as being the single mum, there were quite often the enhanced caring responsibilities that came with that. Bex, I can go on and on, but if there's anything I haven't answered, please do let me know.
No, thank you. So that's really helpful. And I think that you outline very clearly that the gross failure of society to understand different models of family, which is something I think we need to think about more broadly, not just in this committee. And I think that the questions of isolation and the ongoing mental health impacts that's going to have on individuals, but also on society for significant time to come is something that we're going to need to think about how we deal with, because I'm not sure we've got the systems in place just now. I'll leave it there just now, convener. Thank you. I'll come in later on if that's okay. Happy for you to.
Okay, thanks very much. Can I move on to Alexander Stewart, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning, members of the panel. Thank you for your very comprehensive introductions and updates. Can I look at the whole idea of isolation and loneliness and maybe talk to Katrina and then maybe Margaret. Katrina, you represent Age Scotland, and we're well aware of the inequalities that the elderly have faced and continue to face. But there was some real anxiety, there was loss of esteem, there was a lack of ensuring that access to healthcare was taking place. All of that seemed to be the tsunami effect that happened to older people during lockdown. And many of them, as we know, were left to their own devices. And many of them, just because of their age and responsibility to life, chose maybe not to seek help initially, but had to eventually, because of the circumstances they find themselves in. So it would be good to get a flavour, Katrina, from Age Scotland as to how that worked. And then, Margaret, how that impacted on the BEM community and those from ethnic minorities, because once again, the elderly population in these communities had a way of managing themselves, but it maybe wasn't being coordinated appropriately by the services and the policy makers. There was much more informal, and your organisation yourself, you identified in your opening comments that you were doing work on managing all of that within your own groups. So the third sector took on a much bigger role of trying to manage those people. So between the two of you, as I say, I'd like to see what you think are the ways forward here, because we're not finished with this whole process, and there may be lessons to be learned as to how we move forward for the future. So Katrina first.
Thank you for that question. You're absolutely right that the pandemic has had a really profound impact on older people's physical and mental health. And, you know, we know that from what older people themselves are telling us, but also from research which we've done over the course of the pandemic. In terms of sort of loneliness and social isolation, we know that levels of that were high before the pandemic. Our big survey of 3,562 people over 50, which was carried out earlier this year, found that 53% of respondents had actually reported that the pandemic had made them feel lonelier, which doesn't come as a surprise. But, you know, loneliness can have a real impact on somebody's mental health, and it can be a risk factor for developing conditions like depression. It can also have a real physical health impact as well. We are concerned that a lot of older people may have seen a sort of deterioration in their mental health over the course of the pandemic. Again, to pick out something from our big survey, one third of respondents actually said that their mental health had got worse over the last 5 years. Interestingly enough, it's worth noting that people in their 50s and 60s were much more likely to say this. And that, you know, we think that could possibly be because they are sort of part of this sandwich generation, maybe dealing with sort of the pressures of sort of juggling caring for children, older family members, and sort of holding down employment. Looking to the future, I think that it is going to be really important that we have the sort of the support available to people in communities in sort of to support them in getting you know, their confidence back if they haven't been going out and about. We need that to be accessible. We need there to be sort of funding in place to allow that to happen. And yeah, we are really concerned that there is going to be a sort of a longer term impact in terms of people's ability to be independent and be confident and to kind of go about their activities just due to the pandemic. And I suppose the longer that things don't happen, the more likely and or the less likely it is that they aren't going to happen again. And so, yeah, hopefully that was helpful.
Thank you. And Margaret, as I say, identifying what you're trying to do within your own sector for the women who were really left on their own.
Yeah, thank you again very much for that. We all know, we've heard that before the pandemic, people were already lonely and isolated, and most organisations have been trying, you know, to see how they can work to support people who are lonely and isolated. And some of them don't have families, they are ageing, they have underlying health issues, and within the African community and other minority communities, we know that faith is at the heart of everything they do. That's where they get their support. And during the pandemic, all the churches and the centers that were supporting them were all closed down. Elderly, they've never used a computer or don't know how to even set up one, and they don't have access to the internet. This is something that we've been trying to kind of help them, set it up for them, and so they can join groups online, which it did happen with some, but not necessarily with others. We did provide gadgets and dongles so they can join groups. And of course, we also noticed that they couldn't access health services. Those who did not speak English, you phone and they will ask you to call this number or press one and press this. Somebody who doesn't even understand the language, how do they get about pressing one or two to get access, whether it's their medication? So we intervene at that stage, and this is an ongoing issue. There are those who have come here and have made Scotland home, having no families. They don't have access to any support services. The organizations that are trying to support them also have no funding to do that. And looking forward, I think we should actually look at this as a priority and continue, as Katrina said, to fund these projects that are trying to support these communities. Most of them are volunteers, and they're trying, you know, picking up broken pieces, and they're happy to do that. So how can we encourage them by providing them with the funding that they are able to support their communities? Thank you very much. I'm done.
Thank you, Margaret. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. And if can I go to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us. And thank you also for the evidence you've submitted in advance, which has been incredibly helpful. I have a couple of questions, initially for Susie and Katrina, if that's okay. And specifically, I'm keen to understand a bit about what the impact has been on disabled people of having to rely more on unpaid care as well as give unpaid care. and also your assessment of whether or not the budget last week has gone far enough to support unpaid carers and also social care, given the additional pressures that are still present as a result of the pandemic.
Thanks so much, Pam. So Inclusion Scotland carried out an online survey throughout the lockdowns to find out what impact the pandemic was having on disabled people, and particularly disabled women and women who were caring for a disabled child or a disabled person in the household. And the key things that came back in relation to that were that disabled women had new or increased unpaid caring responsibilities. About 40% were experiencing challenges with caring for children or family members. Social care support had been stopped or reduced from around 30% of respondents, so both male and female and non-binary respondents to that question said that their support had either stopped completely or had been reduced. We know that around 2,000, over 2,000 care packages were cut in Glasgow from the 20th of March 2020, many with no notice and no follow-up. Many disabled people were left with no support to wash, to eat, take medications. They were forced to rely on other family members, many of whom were at high risk of the virus themselves. People were forced to rely on friends and neighbours for social care support. So people were thrust into caring roles that they had no training and support for. It's rarely recognised that women are the majority of those in need of social care support, at around 62% of those accessing services in Scotland. And this disproportion increases with age. So 3/4 of social care clients are aged 65 and over, and 67% of this cohort are women. Women are also more likely to be disabled or have long-term health conditions than men. And there are significant geographical disparities with that. So in the most deprived areas of Scotland, 44% of women are disabled, compared with 26% of women in the least deprived areas. We had evidence to show that disabled women and their families were left in desperate situations as a result of cuts to care during lockdown. Disabled women told us they were forced to sleep in their wheelchairs. They were unable to get out of bed. Others told us that they were unable to wash and dress themselves and keep up with basic household chores. One disabled woman told us that she'd gone from 20 hours of care, 7 of which were personal care a week, to 0. She was bedbound completely because of this, and she was having to rely on neighbours to look after her children. In this context, basically, COVID-19 displaced care away from the state and onto the household, and largely women within it. And this further embedded women's poverty and inequality of resources, well-being and participation. So women looking after disabled children went from having their children, for example, having 2-to-1 support in residential accommodation, to then being sent home with no support. Women, including disabled women, often took the brunt of this new or increased caring responsibility. They were trying to juggle childcare of other children with home working, getting no statutory support to care for disabled children. Women spoke of disabled children self-harming, displaying harmful and challenging behaviour and developing disturbed communication because of disruption to routines, social isolation, fear of the virus. They also spoke of having to bear the brunt of unpaid care and domestic housework, and basically feeling abandoned by statutory services. So one disabled respondent said, "I've been abandoned. My partner is a key worker and is hardly at home, and I am left to care for our 2 disabled children, homeschool them, care for them, do the housework, cook and clean, all whilst trying to hold down a part-time job from home. It's impossible. I'm literally screaming into my pillow every night." It was really, really stark, Pam, actually, in terms of the kind of evidence that we were getting from disabled people. People talked about the impact of losing social care support, the emotional impact of a loss of independence and a forced reliance on family, and what that meant for personal relationships, balancing new or increased caring responsibilities with work commitments, and managing their own health conditions while also caring for others. A disabled mother and carer told us that her youngest child not being at school is proving very difficult for her health. She was now struggling to care for her 24 hours a day. She normally got 2 nights respite per week and 1 weekend daytime respite to rest in order to help her pace and cope and keep on top of housework, etc. But the stress and extra care activity was making her symptoms worse. As you'll be very aware, women caring for disabled people in their household often rely on the vital support provided by schools, statutory services, including respite services, and family members to survive on a day-to-day basis. And responses showed that many families, including disabled people, lost some or all of that support, in some cases completely overnight and suddenly with no advance notice. The kind of things that we need to see in terms of the budget, we need a recovery that recognises social care support as a fundamental basic right. We know that rising demand for social care is fast outstripping investment. We know that an approach providing little more than life and limb support to decreasing numbers of people, including disabled people, is just not sustainable. If we are to tackle gender inequality in relation to unpaid care and domestic housework at home, and to tackle gender roles, we need sustained public investment in the development of a nationwide infrastructure for social care to protect, promote and ensure human rights and tackle inequalities for disabled people, older people and carers. We need urgent reform to eligibility criteria. We need care charging to be abolished. These practices are damaging to women's social and economic equality. Social care support is not about providing a personal care service. It's about support to live a life of equity, quality, full participative citizenship. And we need social care support to be funded in a way that means that services are designed and delivered in co-production with disabled people and with women who are impacted by disability. And we need to think about social care as an investment in economic infrastructure. And we believe that development of the National Care Service provides a real opportunity to transform how social care is perceived and how it's valued. And we need to mainstream equalities and impact assessments, and the view of women impacted by disability must inform the design of the National Care Service. Now, I could speak about this all day, so I should probably give someone else an opportunity to speak. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much. I could have listened to that all day. Thank you. Katrina, did you have any contribution as well on the impact of unpaid care on older people, both in terms of want to rely on it, but also having to give it?
So Susie's made some, you know, her really comprehensive points, so I'll just try and be brief. I don't have too much to add on top of that. As you know, people have been saying, it's really clear that carers, unpaid carers, have had to step in to fill the gap in public service provision, and that's obviously had a really detrimental impact on their own physical and mental health. As Susie said, it's really important to be mindful that lots of older carers may themselves be living with long-term health conditions. And in our experience, some unpaid carers can actually also neglect their own health, perhaps due to a lack of time to maybe get to appointments. Although this is something which programmes like Near Me have had a positive impact on, or perhaps because they just can't afford to be ill because there's nobody else to step in. Being a carer can also be a really isolating experience for some people, potentially due to sort of loss of friends and social networks, and sometimes work networks in some cases. I would also just echo Susie's points about social care needing kind of more investment and priority in order to relieve the pressure on unpaid carers, particularly sort of recruitment and retention of social care staff. And absolutely, Susie's absolutely right. We need to see social care as a kind of an investment in everybody's future, everybody's lives.
Thank you very much, both of you, for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I now go to Karen Adam, please?
Hi,
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everyone. I'd like to ask a question really around the job market, the labour market, and the pandemic affected a different set of industries than usual recessions would have and was significantly gender specific. Women and men tend to cluster in different occupations, which shaped the gender implications of the pandemic. Female jobs are more at risk than male ones simply because women are disproportionately represented in sectors that are negatively affected by the COVID-19 crisis. Now, you're all involved in addressing this dilemma within your intersectional lenses. I would like to ask, what are the biggest obstacles in ending this disparity and where can we do more for people in this position? But I suppose that I'd probably like to ask that first to single parents, Single Parent Families Scotland, as it's at one.
Well, thank you. If I can just start off by giving you some figures from some research that the Learning and Work Institute, supported by JRF, did, which showed that single mothers are more likely to have lost their jobs as a result of this crisis, with nearly one in 10 falling out of employment. One in three, that's 34% of single mothers, have been furloughed, compared to just one in four in coupled parents. Single mothers who remained in work saw the biggest decline in hours, with working hours shrinking by an average of 7.6 hours. And single mothers are more likely to say they're finding it difficult to manage their finances and that they're falling behind with their bills than couples with children. And you're right, that is because so many of the single mothers who are in employment are in entry-level jobs in some of the industries and the sectors that you've spoken about, like retail, etc., which were the hardest hit by this pandemic. And actually, we undertook a piece of work with Joseph Andrew Foundation and another one with Oxfam to look to see what could support single parents, single mothers, when we're looking to see what we can do. And one of the things that was really interesting was when they spoke about support post lockdowns, the first two lockdowns, they said that actually anything that we do or anything in terms of support services to support us back into work needs to have mental health and wellbeing support as an integral part of it, because the sort of overwhelming message coming through was that we are not, don't expect to be able to pick up from where we left off before the pandemic as a result of the additional caring responsibilities, stresses, financial stresses and pressures that we'll be having to deal with, as well as some of what I spoke about earlier, the attempts to try to control them by former partners, etc., and the impact that that was having on them. They were saying that's left, you know, we're not where we were. We feel like we've taken some steps backward, and what we now need is support to look to see how we can re-enter work. But within that, how we can re-enter work, which recognises the additional caring responsibilities of being a single mum. And that brings us to the importance of the support services like childcare. Having a childcare infrastructure across Scotland that's affordable, you know, that's available and that provides the flexibility. Because what we don't yet have is the type of labour market we want, which places equal sort of like weight on home and work, you know, which recognises the importance of being family friendly, of looking at the hours that suit the women that we're working with, the single mums, and not the hours that are convenient for the employer, looking at shift patterns, etc. So whilst we're doing some of the more structural changes, we need to look to see how we can put in place the support through childcare, through employment support, through what we can do as we're moving to a different type of economy. When we're looking at a just transition, can we make that a just transition that looks at the needs of single mothers with two young children working in entry-level jobs to ensure that we're building a fairer society and economy as we're trying to change how we do? So there's a big structural changes we can do, but in the short term, it is recognising that for single mums, there have been additional pressures as a result of this. Many have fallen out of work as a result of this. Others have had to reduce their hours of work. And actually what they're saying is that they will need additional support to get themselves back into work. And that is work that we want to look to see how we can ensure there's an adequate income and predictable regular income that enables them to stabilise and to address the support that they want to and their aspirations for themselves and their children.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I wonder if we can hear from Patricia on that point as well. Would that be okay?
Yeah, absolutely. As part of our research, we actually focused on, as one of the kind of key groups that we wanted to hear from, were young women in precarious work. So we spoke to young women in various jobs that were unpredictable or insecure, ranging from 0 hours contracts to freelance work and sex work. And the overarching theme in this area was lack of stability, not knowing what their income was going to be, and lack of support and protection through various government schemes introduced in response to the pandemic. And one group that was kind of specially highlighted in that area were young women who engaged in sex work, and they discussed the difficulty of having to choose between their safety and earning a living and abiding by restrictions. This experience was also challenging for those who worked in the creative sector, with shorter term contracts, being self-employed, being freelancers, and with creative sector taking a massive hit during the pandemic. And one of the things that young women told us could help with all of these issues, other than kind of getting rid of 0 hour contracts and having more stability in employment, was flexibility in the workplace as a starting point, as a baseline, not something that is granted as a privilege. Because many young women who are in precarious work and who had caring responsibilities found it really difficult to progress in workplaces, because the only option for them was to work part-time, which was seen as being less ambitious and meant that they did not have access to the same training opportunities, for example, as those in full-time work. And I think that's one systemic issue that should be addressed fairly quickly if we want to see young women or any woman who are doing unpaid care and domestic work being able to progress equally to men in workplaces.
Okay, thanks very much. Can we now go to Fulton McGregor, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for all the evidence that you've given us so far. It's been it's been really quite thorough and interesting to hear as we take this work forward. Convener, if you don't mind, I've got three broad questions that I'll just work through. They're all obviously related, but they might not flow brilliantly together, so if witnesses just bear with me. My first is around, I think, where Karen Adam was speaking about a wee bit earlier, was about the restrictions and the impact of these on women particularly. Now, I think everybody will be aware that today there's going to be a big announcement from the First Minister. We don't know what that announcement will be yet, but the likelihood seems to be suggesting there may be an imposition of some further restrictions to contain the Omicron variant. My concern with that is, after what I've heard today and last week, and what I guess we know, is that restrictions previously, as well as the virus itself, have impacted women unequally. So what would you say about how restrictions should be framed today? The sectors might need to, I don't know if they need to close, but they might need to be restricted in some sort of way. The households meeting up, or whatever the case is. What advice would you give to the MSPs on this today, for any of us that do have questions this afternoon in the statement? What can we ask to make sure that we don't make the same mistakes first and second lockdown, which weren't, I have to say, just mistakes of the Scottish Government, if you like. They were restrictions that we've seen having the same impact imposed by governments all over the world. So there was something deeply rooted there about the gender inequality and the restrictions. Sorry for the long question, but, and convener, I'm happy for you to pick out the order.
Who do you want to hear from, Fulton?
Yeah, MD is wanting to come in on it. MD is wanting to come in. So I think it's a broad enough question.
Yeah. Sorry, so Satwan, do you want to have a go first?
Okay, right. Thank you very much for that. I think they're very difficult questions in a way to try to answer, being in the situation we're in, being so unprecedented. I think what I would say is that we need to look to see how we can provide more consistent, efficient, regular and predictable support, be that financial support, emotional support, and we look at the unequal impact of this, as you've said, which has become very apparent from all you've heard today and from all that we see around us, to see what we can do and what measures we can put in place to support with things like you're saying, isolation. If there is going to be measures announced around reduced social mixing, for example, and how we can ensure that we are providing the means for digital access when there can't be the face-to-face access, and the support and the resource to families and to those who support them to enable us to maintain some form of connection and connectivity during this period, if there's going to be further measures that are particularly going to exacerbate the isolation and loneliness, which so many single parent families spoke to us about, so many single mums spoke to us about even prior to the pandemic. I think research we undertook, which I can send you a link to, showed 84% of single mums spoke about feeling isolated. That was pre-pandemic. And what we saw was an increase and a spike in that, and the impact on them. But I do think in the first lockdown, we were in sort of like crisis emergency mode in terms of how do we respond. By the second lockdown, we'd managed to nail some of that down and recognise there were gaps in the way that we'd responded. And I think if there are any further restrictions announced now, it is acknowledging the unequal impact of this and therefore ensuring that in the support measures we're able to put in place, we're able to provide that priority support to those who we know are the most impacted, not just by the pandemic, but by the measures we have to put in place to try to manage it.
Thanks.
And if we can go to Susie now, please.
So just really to build on what Satwat said, we are looking really for the Scottish Government to really learn from the evidence that disabled people's organisations have provided about the impact of the first two lockdowns on disabled people, and to really kind of use that evidence to try and to formulate new responses if indeed further restrictions are likely to be announced. And the key things that we would call for really are an assurance to disabled people who receive social care that their social care will not be reduced or stopped as a result of further restrictions. We know that the Scottish Government committed emergency funding to local authorities when social care support was stopped during the first lockdown, but we also are failing to know. It was very difficult to find out whether or not that funding actually found its way to social care recipients. So we really want assurances that social care will be maintained if further restrictions are to be brought in. We also need to make sure that our responses are bespoke in relation to people who are at high risk of the virus and who are shielding. So we need to maintain shielding support and particularly digital access for people who are shielding, for disabled people who are shielding. We really need to involve disabled people as the experts in their own lives in emergency planning in the future. And this can be anything from making sure that communication about restrictions is available in accessible formats, making sure that, I mean, obviously we have had BSL interpretation for the First Minister's updates in Scotland, but the UK government did not have BSL interpretation, hasn't had BSL interpretation throughout the pandemic, which has actively excluded BSL users from hearing very important public health information. We want to make sure that involvement and participation of disabled people is part and parcel of how we kind of live with COVID-19 as it seems we have to do. So yes, if I could leave any one takeaway message today, it would be that we need to ensure that social care support is maintained if further restrictions come in.
Thank you. Can I go to Maggie Chapman, please?
Thanks very much, Joe, and thank you for that. I wanted to unpick a couple of points around Satwat, you mentioned coercion and the control that some lone mums will experience. Others have also touched on this. Pam Gosol, who sends her apologies today, was interested in exploring some of the high levels of domestic abuse and violence that we know have come out through the pandemic, not only in BAME communities and ethnic minority groups, but more generally. I suppose just to ask panel members, if you, what your thoughts are around current service provisions, whether our policies are adequate enough, whether we actually have the right support mechanisms in place, either to support people who are currently in abusive or violent situations, what we can be doing better. And I appreciate that, particularly for carers in paid and unpaid work. There'll be additional vulnerabilities around domestic abuse and domestic violence. So it's a really, really keen to hear different people's views on that. If I could ask Satwat first, and then see if anybody else wants to pick this up. I'm sure Margaret will.
Thank you. Sorry, it's such a complex question to try to answer quickly, so do bear with me. I think in terms of current services and provisions, this is an area that could do with additional support and investment, particularly if we're looking at further restrictions coming in, because what many of the single mums that we work with lost as a result of all that was the peer support, yeah, the informal support that would enable them to have someone they could go to say what was going on. And I think it was that knowing that there was going to be that greater isolation which resulted in some of the higher levels of control and abuse that they experienced and they spoke to. And also, people don't necessarily think about single mums are still experiencing ongoing domestic abuse, but that's another issue we need to address around what people's perceptions are of the group of mothers that we support. And so much of it is around economic domestic abuse as well, and control, withholding payments, etc. And that was, particularly difficult when many of the families that we worked with didn't necessarily have at the beginning of the pandemic the access to the online facilities to be able to get them to get the advice and the support that they needed. So I think that would be critical, that the means are there for the support and that the information is available so that women know proactively where they can go and what they can do, as opposed to feeling that, that they're in a situation where there is really no one around who can help them. So in terms of additional support, I would say that we definitely need to look at that. In terms of the policies, we need to make sure we're being as inclusive as we can and understanding some of the complexities of the situations that women find themselves in, even after they've left an abusive partner, where there are children involved, and the coercion that comes around that. And making sure that we are investing over this period in those frontline services that can provide the support to the women that we're talking about, and that we're connected with each other, so we know exactly where to be able to support women.
That's really helpful. Thank you, Satwat. I know Patricia wants to come in. So, Patricia, do you want to come in next, and then I'll go to Margaret?
I think the issue with the kind of current service provision is that all of our models are built on face-to-face supports and creating physical safe spaces that women can access to get support that they need, to have that peer-to-peer sort of informal support that Satwat mentioned as well. And when we moved all of our services into online delivery, I don't think we had time or resources to really address the digital gap, to address access to technology and devices, but also address the fact that for many women in domestic abuse situation, home is really not a safe space, and we do not know who is controlling the devices. So even if there is funding available to give them devices or to provide them with online training, we don't know who else is sitting in the room with them. And I think that is something, if we are going into further restrictions, this is really something that we need to address, because I think we are missing a lot of women in terms of being able to provide them with adequate support if it's not face-to-face support. And I think that's an area that I really would like to highlight. And I do not have answers, just thoughts, but I think it is something that we definitely need to concentrate our efforts on if we are looking at another year of coming in and out of lockdowns, because some women would not have any access to support in those situations that they are in. And also going back to kind of precarious work and women losing income, I think that's another kind of intersection that is worth exploring, kind of trapping women in domestic abuse situation because of loss of income as a result of pandemic, and especially those who have children or caring responsibilities on top of that.
Thanks, Patricia. That's a really, really, really clear outline of some of the barriers and the issues around digital replacements for face-to-face meeting spaces. And I think we probably need to think a little bit more creatively and a little bit more imaginatively about that. Margaret, I'm aware that ethnic minority women face additional exclusions around not only digital poverty but other sort of safe spaces to meet, and there'll be cultural issues as well that maybe we need to be a little bit clearer in our understanding about. What would you like to say in response?
Well, thank you very much. I was just gonna kind of highlight domestic violence, which is at the rise, and there is a lot of underreporting, maybe due to the cultural and religious beliefs and the shame that could bring on the families. And some of this underreporting also could be because women are scared that if they report, their children are going to be removed from them. However, in working with them, it's rather to reassure them about the information and the support that is in place for them, rather than, you know, threaten them. Sorry, that may be the wrong word to use. If the information is clearly put out there, they would understand that, yeah, there is support for me, because women are tied into a violent relationship, maybe because if they leave, the visa is going to be withdrawn, or they're still dependent on their partners. They have to undergo all of that without speaking to anybody. And in terms of providing support, sometimes you may phone a woman who's got issues and they cannot talk because of the environment in which they are. I would give an example. I tried to speak to somebody and I realized that the connection was not stable. And I said, are you okay to talk? Are you okay to talk? Where are you? I'm in the wardrobe. So if somebody has something to say, you're there to provide support, and they cannot talk, then there is a gap. There is a gap. And one of the speakers also highlighted that our policies are designed for face-to-face work. We also need to understand that some people cannot access the internet, are not computer literate. How do we work with these people to ensure that we are providing them with the right information? And then if the police are also going to interview families, they should also be aware of that cultural differences, how information that somebody can disclose, and how sometimes they say some words not really meaning what they are saying. Is to understand them, not to take them to task, for using some words, because that's how they learn those words. That's how they were brought up. They are learning and they are continuing to learn every day. So we need to understand some of these communities and that they have other additional needs. They may have children with special needs, and that impacts on their mental health and well-being. If you have 3-4 children in different classes, you go to school, you become a teacher by default. Sometimes it can be overwhelming for parents and women in particular, that may impact on their attitude and the relationship that they find themselves in. So it's about looking at culturally sensitive ways to work with these families so that they can come up, so that they can feel free to talk with us and know that there is support there for them, rather than we're going to take your children away. And that's not it. The social services are there to support families, but also they need to invest in themselves to be able to understand the people that they support. Thank you.
Thanks, Margaret. That's really helpful. And I think it's really useful that you mentioned, we've talked about social services and other support services, but I think it's really important that you brought the police into this discussion. And we maybe need to think about some of the conversations that we can have with the police around those cultural sensitivities and cultural understanding. So it doesn't come down to, blind enforcement of a policy. There is sensitive understanding around different situations. So thank you very much for that. And thanks, Joe. I'll leave it there for now.
Okay, thank you. Can we go to Alexander Stewart now, please?
Thank you, convener. When we're talking about the impact on physical health, there is the indication that long COVID seems to be affecting more women than men, and the effects that has with them and within the labour market. It would be quite good to get an idea of what some people's views are with reference to that, because some and most women who work part-time, that their employers have an inadequate response to how that is managed, about how they are coping with long COVID, and women are more likely to be in jobs that may not entitle them to some statutory sick pay, etc. So maybe can I ask Susie to give us a feeling of how that is being impacted and where we see that progressing?
So I believe that women who report having symptoms of long COVID, I think the evidence suggests that they outnumber men by as much as 4-1. The evidence on this is obviously emerging, so there's questions being asked as to why this is. The hypothesis that I've seen most often is that long COVID is in essence an autoimmune response to the virus. It's an autoimmune disorder, if you like. And 80% of all autoimmune disorders are experienced by women. That's, aside from COVID and the symptoms of long COVID. So I've seen some of the discussions from autoimmune specialists and virologists about that. And that's really what people are thinking, that women are more likely to experience an autoimmune disorder. We know in terms of the impact on the labour market that women who experience ill health and disabled people are at risk in relation to their employment, particularly women in part-time employment. We know that employers may well be struggling or not have sufficient guidance and advice to know how to respond to employees that have long COVID. We've had anecdotal evidence from disabled people that they're finding it very difficult to get support from GPs about the symptoms of long COVID, and that they are finding it very difficult to find support networks and peer support networks. I mean, the evidence around disabled people's employment in relation to previous economic downturns suggests that activity rates for disabled people
increase during emergency situations, activity rates fall for disabled people, and wage gaps widen. So that's obviously a significant issue for disabled people, and obviously for people with long COVID. We know that disabled workers, that could potentially include people with long COVID, are substantially high risk of being made redundant or having their hours reduced. So yes, I think there's obvious issues here, and there are obvious gender issues here with long COVID. We'll be really keeping an eye on this and seeing how it develops.
Thank you, convener.
Can I go to Pam Duncan-Clancy, please?
Thank you, convener, and thanks again for everyone's responses. Could I ask Susie in the first instance, and also Satwa, how the increase in unpaid work could impact on government plans for the No One Left Behind approach in employment, and also the aims to reduce the employment gap of disabled people by half? Thank you.
So for us, the work to tackle the disability employment gap really needs a shift in focus. So employability support for disabled people has been really concentrated on trying to upskill disabled people themselves. So in employment, as with many areas of everyday life, Scots disabled people went into this pandemic worse off than non-disabled people. We know that the employment gap between disabled and non-disabled people of working age is higher in Scotland than elsewhere in the UK. We know that disabled people are almost twice as likely to be unemployed as non-disabled people. We know that the Scottish Government have committed to halving the employment gap by 2038, with interim milestones, which mean that the employment rate needs to increase by around one percentage point each every year. And by 2023, the employment rate should stand at 50%, and by 2030, it should be 60% for disabled people. Now, when that target was set in 2018, we considered that a target of 20 years for only halving the disability employment gap, we felt that it showed a distinct lack of ambition. But we're obviously very concerned that as a result of the pandemic, that those targets won't be met. Many disabled people in work already have to leave their jobs when they acquire an impairment or when their condition worsens, and they don't get the support or workplace adjustments that they need. We know that loss of employment opportunities contributes to disabled people living in poverty, and we know that unemployment results in demoralising rejection, increased pessimism, underconfidence and poor mental health for disabled people. We also know that the barriers disabled people face in getting ready for and getting into and staying in and getting on in work are many and varied and quite complicated, and they include stigma, poor attitudes, inaccessible application processes and discriminatory practices, including a lack of opportunities for promotion and development, retention and sick leave policies that actually actively discriminate against disabled people. We know that inaccessible transport and workplaces and a lack of accessible housing could also play a part in preventing disabled people finding or progressing at work. So I think what the overriding message for us is that for too long, support services and national and local strategies have focused on what people think are disabled people's employability issues. In other words, what needs to change about us as disabled people and what support we need. And therefore, support for employment is often targeted at addressing disabled people's perceived lack of skills or education, or the difficulty that we have with managing our health conditions, or our perceived lack of confidence or motivation. So In other words, it's disabled people who are expected to change and improve in order to be better suited to the existing world of work. And we believe that there's a deeply skewed allocation of responsibility for addressing the disability employment gap, with much higher demands on disabled people than are presently put on employers and other organisations. For example, it's disabled people who are penalised when they're not able to gain or retain employment, but employers continue to be largely unaccountable if they don't create inclusive workplaces. So just to give you an example of this, disabled people are over 60 times more likely than employers to face sanctions for non-compliance with requirements in relation to work-related benefit. In 2015-16, disabled people were sanctioned almost 70,000 times for missing appointments or infringing work-related conditions of benefit payment, with resulting reductions in benefit. Employers in the same year were in effect sanctioned only around 1,000 times when disability discrimination cases were either settled or won by a disabled person at an employment tribunal. So I suppose what I'm really saying, and what the pandemic has really highlighted, is that we've got systemic inequality when it comes to disabled people's employment. And we really need a shift in focus to think about, rather than thinking about employability, we need to be thinking about employerability. What can employers do to support disabled people? What can they do to create inclusive workplaces? What advice and guidance do they need? What support with HR? What support with providing reasonable adjustments in the workplace? What support with access to work do they need? And how can we make our workplaces in Scotland much more accessible to disabled people?
I think I'm going to go to Satchbats now.
Thank you. I would just say all of the above in terms of what Susie's just said. I thought that was fantastic sort of summary of what some of the issues are that many of them, the specific groups that we're here to talk about, experience collectively and generally. But I mean, Pam, going back to your question, I do think that in terms of no one left behind and the employment gap, we need to look at some of the support services that we need in place for single parents throughout. And you know, every time we speak to single parents about what the biggest issue is around this for them, it comes back to childcare support, family-friendly working practices, and how, like I said, that the labour market is structured. In terms of no one left behind, I agree that with what Susie said, that at the moment there is a sort of deficit model in terms of how we look to see what the range of issues are that, say, single mums need supported with. It's sort of turning it around in terms of the assets that they have that they can bring into the labour market, but how we support them through how we can restructure that. I do think there is still a need for tailored specific support. One of the big things that we hear time and again is that they want a job that will fit in with their family. Family comes first. Caring responsibilities are critically important, but undervalued, as we've spoken about, or not valued or recognised before. And the employer attitudes and how we can support employers to understand the benefits of being more flexible and family friendly, I think, is critical. I mean, we had some parents spoke about, my supervisor doesn't understand. They'll say, well, I've got kids and I work, but what they don't realise is they might have support. They might have family that can help. I don't have that. I've seen what it's like. They tell you they're flexible, but they mean you need to be flexible for them. But it should go both ways. You worry when you ask about flexibility or time off for your kids, you know they will just replace you. So there is that fear that keeps many of the mums that we work with in low-paid, precarious work in which they're underemployed because of the fear factor of moving somewhere else and losing whatever flexibilities they might have gained through the length of service that they've had there. And the other thing I want to say is that in order to be able to support the women we work with to move beyond entry-level jobs, we need to look at how we create a pathway which recognises the importance of qualifications, supporting women to be able to study and have financial security and stability when doing so, in order to be able to progress in the workplace in terms of progression to different jobs, increasing the hours at work, and looking to see how we can support with that, which does, of course, come back to having a comprehensive social care and childcare infrastructure to support women and families.
Thank you. Can we now go to Karen Adam?
Thank you, convener. It's very overwhelming, everything that you've been talking to us about this morning. I mean, it's very clear that there were many inequalities already there, and as has been said, you know, really highlighted by the COVID-19 pandemic. These are things that perhaps women and you know, intersectionally have been shouting about, trying to get the message across for generations, really. And I know that, you know, it's fantastic we're discussing this today and we're hearing from yourselves today. But what really can we do to make, you know, a massive shift here? We've heard about patriarchal structures. I mean, just hearing the evidence that, you know, 80% of people with autoimmune diseases are women, but yet women are less likely to take time off to go to the doctor or take time off for childcare because of perceptions. So is there a deeper underlying cause here on top of, you know, those practical and policy changes that we need to do? I suppose that's a more general, higher level kind of question, but really interested to get your feedback on that. And I'd like to open it to anybody who'd like to come in, really.
Should we start with Katrina?
Sure. I think that that's a really complicated question to answer, but I'll do my best to give you some thoughts. I think that it's really going to be quite essential for us to kind of place more importance on the role provided by unpaid carers. Just looking at kind of workplace issues, you know, it really isn't as valued as it should be to, if somebody's got a gap in their CV, trying to kind of explain that away. You know, oh, I was providing unpaid care, whether that be childcare to an older relative. Like, there just isn't the sort of recognition by employers that that is a really important contribution that somebody has made. And yeah, I think there's probably more practical measures in terms of support for carers which we could put in place in the workplace which would help with these things. You know, specifically kind of employability strategies focusing on carers either while they're in work or maybe after a gap in caring to help them get back into work. Obviously, there's things like the Carer Positive Accreditation Scheme, which are really positive, but, you know, just doing more to kind of embed that practical recognition and support for carers, giving carers kind of access to resources so that they can pursue training opportunities to help them with their caring role and kind of to help them beyond their caring role are also really important. And yeah, just making sure that any carer who is potentially sort of at risk of redundancy due to the sort of caring role which they're provided, you know, so that they have the support that they need. So yeah, practical measures to support carers, hopefully.
And Patricia, please.
Yeah, it is such a big question, but yeah, I'll try to unpack some of the issues. I think it requires like an entire systemic overhaul. When it comes to our approach to employment, starting with the application process, which is something that Katrina touched upon, that it's very difficult to explain gaps in employment, and maybe we need to think about different application process, different recruitment process. We need more education and training for young women, kind of embedding confidence building, skills recognition, and skills recognition for those who are doing unpaid care, and recognizing that actually as an employment, as a form of employment, as a form of gaining skills, and employees recognizing that as well as something that is extremely valuable. As I said before, we need more flexibility. Flexibility should be the baseline. It shouldn't be a privilege. that people need to ask for, and that they might be rejected. I think last 2 years have proven to all of us that we can work more flexibly, and it must be very difficult for people who had those previous requests for flexible working rejected. Now seeing that, you know, entire companies and our entire economy adapted to more flexible way of working, and I think we shouldn't be even thinking about going back to the way that we used to work. We need increased opportunities for women. For women with caring responsibilities, for women who are returning to work, support and training, and yeah, just a wider societal change, societal shift, overhauling our current system, tackling existing power structures that keep women in lower paid and lesser valued employment. And there's definitely something around what sort of value we attach to certain forms of employment, and how little value we attach to employment that is dominated by women. And that's kind of ensuring that women remain dependent on men, both financially and as power holders in terms of our careers and experiences in the workplace. So many things to tackle, but I think, you know, I'm happy that we are at least, I think that's one silver lining of the, you know, last 2 years, that we are now looking at these things seriously, and we are starting to have those wider, deeper conversations that I think those in our sector were having for many, many years previously.
Thank you.
Go to Satwat, please.
Thank you. I'm just going to mention two specific things that might help. And I think one of the critical things that we need to build in to everything that we're doing is ensuring that the women that we're all working with the direct experience are at the centre of the conversations to design what we need to do as we continue to live with this crisis, and also when we begin to emerge out of it, and recognising the diversity of families, including single parent families, and when implementing policy and designing services in response to COVID-19, having that at the centre, those who've experienced this most acutely, and what we can do to develop and to build onwards from here in a way which doesn't entrench the inequalities that we've seen being so exacerbated. And one of the things that we at One Parent Families Scotland have done is support Oxfam Scotland's campaign to add a national outcome on care, Scotland's national performance framework. We want recognition that the COVID-19 pandemic has reinforced the crucial importance of care, paid and unpaid, most of it carried out by women, to all our lives. And too often, caring for someone, be it an adult or a child, results in significant personal and economic costs for the individual and the family. So we would support making Scotland one of the first countries in the world to include such an explicit cost-cutting and comprehensive commitment to care and the role of carers within their performance framework.
Thank you. And can we go to Susie, please?
So yes, I'm just going to echo the points that Satwat has made. I think that if the Scottish Government is serious about an economic recovery and a social recovery and renewal from COVID-19 that really centres equality and sustainability and tackling gender roles, they really need to embed women's equality in the redesign of social care. And that needs to be a key principle in founding the National Care Service. So quality care must be universally accessible and free at the point of need. So social care support must be universally accessible. There must be minimum standards of support in a system which allows women to have control and flexibility. As we look towards how we are going to live with COVID-19, we need to adequately resource social care support, and we need to recognise its wider role in enabling women's quality of life and their participation and their contribution. And just
just to really reiterate what SATWAT has so passionately advocated for, we need to involve women who are impacted by disability. So disabled women and those caring for a disabled person must be listened to, and they must be involved in emergency planning. Our participation as disabled women needs to be front and centre of policy and decision making as we work out how to manage and live with COVID-19, not just for things that are specifically about disabled people, but in all decisions that affect us. And for this to happen, policy and decision makers and service providers need to understand that our lives are complicated. We're not just women or disabled people. We're employers, we're employees, we're learners, we're parents, and we live in different parts of the country. And as disabled people, we're more likely to be living in poverty, and we're more likely to have higher costs. And those things need to be taken into account when working out what we do next.
You, I wonder, Margaret, do you want to come in on this point?
Actually, yeah, all the previous speakers, they've actually kind of read my script, which is great. So it makes it easy for me. What I'm going to echo here, it's about actually understanding the community that we serve. We cannot provide support to anyone without actually understanding where they are and where they want to be. In terms of unpaid work or carers unpaid work, I've realized within the BME community that most women, they get trapped in zero-hour contracts because the one work that is going to be centered around their children. They don't want to work. If you kind of employ them, say, okay, I want you to work Monday to Friday, they can't do that because they need to be there for their children. And if they're going to leave their children, then social services is going to come and take my children. Most of these women, they want to contribute. Childcare is an issue to participation. If we want to involve women, then we need to be flexible. We need to understand the circumstances in which they find themselves. If we're going to find more restrictions coming again, that's causing a lot of anxiety, a lot of uncertainty, stress, and that leads to depression, which also impacts on the mothers and their children. If you don't have a family here, you want to work. And considering volunteering as a job, that we call them unpaid staff, they do the same. But we need to also recognize that aspect and provide them the support that they need to upskill themselves. Some come here with degrees, but they can't get a job. When they apply for jobs, they say, you got no experience. And how can they have the experience when they don't have this opportunity to show what they have got? So we need to look at how we support them to upgrade skills, and that it should also be flexible and inclusive. It should be inclusive. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks everyone. I think that brings us really to the end of that, the time that we have for that session. We've gone over time by quite a bit, but I think we could have kept discussing these topics. They are so important, and I'm sure the committee will come back to some of these issues in future work that we do. So a huge thank you to all of our witnesses for attending today. That does, as I say, bring the public part of our meeting to a close. Our next meeting will be on Tuesday, the 11th of January. It will be a fully virtual meeting. We'll begin our stage one oral evidence of the Minor Strike Pardon Scotland Bill. We'll now close the public part of this meeting and move into private for our final items of the agenda. Thank you all.